Try and tie it in as much as possible to people's concerns that are already manifested, such as climate change. The CETA Star did a wonderful job last year at the PGS conference saying that this is a climate change issue as well. So it's not one or the other. It's both at once, except this can happen overnight, literally. The other thing is radiation. Now, in addition to the instantaneous irradiation, which is a blast of radiation occurring at the time of the physical blast, there's also the fission products, the residues, which go into the environment and which follow different pathways to different organs in the body. Iodine-131 going to the thyroid gland. Strontium-90, which is related to calcium chemically, goes to the bones. That's where calcium goes, and goes to mother's milk, because that's where calcium goes. And cesium-137, which is related to potassium chemically, goes to the blood and the soft tissues, and therefore into the meat of animals, which then gets becomes a problem of contamination of the food supply. So this is what people need to realize, is that we're not talking about some invisible ray here, like somebody from outer space who fires a phaser at you. We're talking about hundreds of new elements which nature did not know during the entire evolution of life on Earth. Most of these elements are man-made. They're created by the splitting of the uranium atom. And they all follow their own pathways. And they often talk about natural radiation. Well, these things are not natural. And to compare it with natural radiation is fallacious, chemically, biologically, scientifically, because these things go into the body and become incorporated into the body, and it's there that they give off their radiation bursts. It's like having little X-ray machines inside you. Now, there are natural radioactive materials that do that as well, but these specific ones, no. Now, the way I first learned about the health effects of radiation was through a dispute. Linus Pauling, during the atmospheric testing, did a marvelous job of exercising his social conscience by broadcasting the fact that they were killing thousands of Americans every year through these atmospheric tests. He predicted 96,000 deaths per year just in America, just from the fallout from these atmospheric tests. Now, the Atomic Energy Commission and the American government were outraged at this, and they said, we've got to get somebody to shoot this man down, because he's doing us a lot of damage, and he's setting back the cause of national security. So they said, who are we going to get? They said, why don't we get John Goffman? John Goffman was a man who was a nuclear physicist in his early incarnation, and who was actually one of the co-discoverers of some of the elementary properties of fission from the early days. He worked with Glenn Seaborg as a student. But later, he changed his career entirely and became a medical doctor, quite a renowned medical doctor. He won some prestigious awards in studying the role of lipoproteins in heart disease. So they said, why don't we get John Goffman? He's our guy. He will help us out. So they approached John Goffman and they said, would you please study the effects of radiation and give your verdict on it, because we want to rebut Linus Pauling. And he said, he refused at first. He said, what credibility would I have if I was working for you? And they said, well, we'll give you complete freedom to publish what you want. He said, where would I work? Where would I carry out this research? They said, you could work at the Lawrence Radiation Lab. At that time, Edward Teller was in charge of the Lawrence Radiation Lab. He says, there's no way on earth I will work under Edward Teller. So what they did was they made him co-director of the Lawrence Radiation Lab so that he did not have to report to Edward Teller. Nevertheless, when he came out with his conclusion was that instead of 96,000 deaths per year, there would only be 32,000 deaths per year. He thought they'd be happy about this. They were not happy at all. And myself was just beginning to educate myself. I had taken on the editorship of a newsletter called Survival, and I wrote to John Goffman and asked him to send me material that I could print. And this is how I learned his story. He said that when he started this, he assumed that there would be a safe level of radiation. But after 7 years of intensive study of all the evidence, he was inexorably brought to the conclusion that there is no safe dose of radiation. And that, in fact, we are killing people at even low doses, exposed to large groups of people, is going to cause a lot of deaths. So what is the nature of the radiation hazards? This is a man who his name is Smitherman, And he developed cancers of lymphoma. His legs have been amputated. And his problem was that he was a sailor. And as a sailor, he had been ordered to be on a ship witnessing the atomic bomb test. Thousands and thousands of soldiers were ordered to go and witness atomic bomb tests. After the bomb test, he was swabbing down the deck of the ship, and he was dressed in a t-shirt and shorts, and he noticed down the other end of the deck there were two guys dressed in moon suits with a device. They were sweeping the deck of the ship, measuring radiation. He said, "That's funny. Why are they dressed like that and I'm dressed like this?" And of course, the effects of radiation at low doses are not immediate. They take years to develop. And years later, many, many, many of these people developed cancers and other crippling diseases caused by the effects of the radiation. Oftentimes these people are called atomic guinea pigs, but they were not guinea pigs. Because if you have guinea pigs, you study them. Nobody wanted to study these men. They wanted to use them in order to see if they could still fight, if they could witness an atomic bomb test and still fight. And the answer was, yes, they can. What happens to them later? They were not interested. They did not follow them up. They did not study them. They never professed any interest in this. And that's where the medical profession comes in. Scientists and doctors and medical people who are not affiliated with this enterprise are needed to really not only help the victims, but also to publicize and explain what is really going on here. Remember how long it took for people to appreciate the dangers of smoking. I mean, when I was a kid, everybody smoked, you know, doctors smoked, movie stars smoked. On the big screen, you know, if you weren't smoking, you didn't look cool. And the thing is that people were not falling down dead from smoking. And it has the same effect as this long delay, which makes it difficult for the mind to absorb what the effects really are. Even today in Quebec, young people are smoking like chimneys in many cases, and they just don't seem to be able to, you know, it takes a tremendous act of the imagination to realize what's really going on with smoking. It's not obvious. Same thing with radiation. Now, this is Irma Thomas. She was one of the downwinders. They always exploded these tests when the wind was blowing away from Las Vegas, because they weren't stupid. They knew that the people in Las Vegas could send hitmen and so on. So what they did, therefore, was they always exploded the tests when they were blowing towards this town of St. George, Utah. And years later, and people were invited. They actually had leaflets inviting people to go out in the nighttime and look at the beautiful explosion, because it's all the colors of the rainbow and it's a great thing to see. But they would be washed with waves of radiation fallout, and years later she herself went around door to door and just recorded how many people had cancers, leukemias and other ailments, and this resulted in a court case that did achieve some degree of satisfaction. This is another man, Michael Dworkin was involved in this as well, right here at the Jewish General Hospital. He just lived a stone's throw from here. He was one of 600 Canadian soldiers, military men, who were ordered to go to Chalk River to clean up after a nuclear accident there. 600 of them. And they went there and they were marched into the reactor building to scrub down the walls and so on, because there had been a fire which spread fission products all through the interior of the building. This man had hundreds of operations for skin cancers all over his body, including he had both his breasts removed, he had cancers in the anus, he had cancers in places where you don't normally get sunshine damage. But again, we went to court for him and we got him compensation. It took 7 times, and we had to bring in experts from other parts of the world to testify on his behalf. And nobody was interested in actually studying his illness. Nobody was interested in actually exploring what might have actually happened to the bodies of these men. There was a doctor here, a pathologist, Herb Swalowitz, who took some skin tissues and he showed them to his colleagues at medical conferences. Nobody had ever seen anything like it. But you know what? The nuclear industry, the government of Canada, they weren't interested. That's why we really need people who are medically knowledgeable and who are willing to publicize and explain the results of these things, because the industry and the government, they just want to turn a blind eye to it. It just gets in their way. It's not something which is going to help them in any way, shape, or fashion. and therefore they'd rather just ignore it. Now,